Helsingland, Sweden. An idyllic paradise of love, sex, and drugs, and the perfect place for American student Danny Arter to grieve the sudden and violent deaths of her sister and her parents. Awkwardly invited by her emotionally distant boyfriend Christian and his friends, Danny is thrust headfirst into the culture of this remote Swedish village. But as things begin to turn sinister, she realizes this carefree village is hiding a few dark secrets from her and her traveling companions. But the scariest truth? Danny just might embrace the madness. The second film from rising horror star Ari Aster, this is the divisive but gorgeous Midsommar. Happy Wednesday, you lovely bastards. You may have noticed our badass new intro music, composed and performed by my talented cousin Ryan Leone. If you enjoy hearing the film's theme every week, don't fret. You'll still hear it at the end of the episode as a little post-podcast outro. As you may have guessed, this is Filmgazm, the little horror podcast that could. And I'm Connor Eyzaguirre, your odd Swedish friend who has convinced you to take a little trip to Helsingland to celebrate Midsommar with the Harga. Don't be afraid, just drink this and you'll feel better. Joining me is Austin Johnson, my willingly suicidal senior citizen, whose head will be making good friends with an oversized mallet in just a few minutes here. Before we get into Midsommar and our thoughts on the film that righteously pissed me off for reasons even I don't fully understand, we hope you enjoyed last week's epic Godfather extravaganza. We do enjoy Weird Shit Wednesday, and we work especially hard to ensure that every fifth episode is a special one for you. Speaking of, our upcoming episode 25 will be another career retrospective, this time on Joel and Ethan Coen, the iconic writing and directing duo behind such cult classics as Raising Arizona, No Country for Old Men, and The Big Lebowski, among many others. We will be talking about each and every one of their 18 films thus far, as well as how their careers began and flourished. No scandals behind them, so expect a nice reflective episode focusing on two of our favorite filmmakers. Gonna be awesome.
Can't wait. Oh boy. That's gonna be our favorite episode we've ever done. Probably,
yeah,
right there. It's
very much looking forward to that.
It's gonna be very long too. So buckle up, get some food. We're gonna do the same thing. So.
Oh yeah, big sesh.
Be ready for a huge episode 25.
Now for the rewind. Two updates are for last week's Godfather episode, and I got one for Quentin Tarantino. First up, Tarantino has announced that he has been talking to Uma Thurman about finally doing Kill Bill Volume 3. In an article from IndieWire, Tarantino said, quote, "Me and Uma have talked about it recently, frankly, to tell you the truth. I've thought about it a little further. We were talking about it literally last week. If any of my movies were going to spring from my other movies, it would be a third Kill Bill." However, he remains adamant that he will retire after 10 films, so we'll see. But just the idea that he's talking about it means that it's being brought back into the ether. So, you know, I would love a Kill Bill 3.
Oh, of course.
But he's been talking about it since 2005, and I'm not holding my breath.
Yeah, same. Exactly. I'm not getting my hopes up. And like you said about the 10 films.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we'll see.
This comes back every few years. Whenever Tarantino releases a new one, people start talking about Kill Bill 3. So, we'll see, but I doubt it.
Yeah.
Maybe a novel someday, but I doubt it'll be a movie.
Hold your breath, yeah.
And if it is a movie, it probably won't be by Quentin Tarantino.
Exactly.
He'll produce it, but that'll be it. Next up, I had neglected to mention the two video games that were made from the franchise The Godfather.
Oh, yeah.
2006 is The Godfather, and 2009 is The Godfather Part 2, both of which were based on the films of the same title. In the first game, you play as Aldo Trapani, an original character whose various jobs intersect with the film's plot. He hides the horse head in Waltz's bed, he drives Vito Corleone to the hospital after he's shot, and he plants the gun that Michael used to kill the Turk. I haven't played it, but it sounds really cool. It features original voice work from James Caan, Robert Duvall, Abe Vigoda, and Marlon Brando in some recorded dialogue.
I want to play this.
He was ill, like he died right after, but
wow.
He recorded a bit.
Man, yeah. Really cool. I remember seeing that on IMDb. You can see that, like, because they did the voice work.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I forgot. Sorry we didn't mention that. I'm sure there's someone out there who loves those games.
Yeah. Well, I played part two. I did the sequel, and that was a lot of fun.
Awesome.
I really enjoyed that.
Awesome.
And that one you play as Dominic, a soldier moving up in Michael's crime family. And he plays a more central role in the game, appearing in crucial scenes from the film. He's the guy who guns down Hyman Roth.
Okay.
Stuff like that. And only Robert Duvall reprises his role in that game, with Al Pacino declining. He instead chose to do the 2006 game, Scarface, The World Is Yours. And that game was not a success, and they scrapped the plans to adapt Part 3, which, I don't know how you turn Godfather 3 into a video game.
Yeah, what do you do? What does your character do?
I don't know, maybe you're Andy Garcia banging your cousin, I don't know. But yeah, it's just, I don't get it. For my second update for The Godfather, I watched 1990's The Freshman, starring Marlon Brando as a caricature of Don Corleone named Carmine Sabatini. I found the film to be too tame, and I thought Brando was about the only thing worth watching in the film. Felt like a Nickelodeon mob movie. The gangsters were goofy. They were like Fat Tony from The Simpsons, but even he had some kind of a bloodlust. And I gave it a 6, and that was pretty much just for the performances above all else. And I did read a really cool story that happened during production that I just had to share here.
Okay.
So, during the filming, Brando and Matthew Broderick and the director went out for lunch, and they ran into John Gotti. At the Ravenite Social Club, which was Gotti's headquarters.
Oh my gosh.
And Brando, being Marlon Brando, was like, I gotta say something. I'm sure they were like, don't you fucking say a word. Please don't. But no, he's like, I'm the Godfather. I should go say something. So he broke the ice with a card trick, which went off without a hitch. But then Brando quipped to Gotti, quote, you know, you could make a living this way.
Oh my God.
Everyone went silent. And Brando suddenly realized that he just made Gotti look like a fool. So he's like, what do I do now? So he said goodnight, and he and the rest of his party got the hell out of there before anything could happen.
Oh my goodness.
And wow, what are the odds?
The chances of that are ridiculous.
When he went to the table, one of Gotti's men was like, will the real Godfather please stand up? And I get, oh my God.
Oh man.
I don't know who was more like freaked out there. I mean,
jeez. Yeah, those are two just titans coming at each other.
It's fantastic. And, of course, John Gotti was responsible for a lot of murder and died in prison. Marlon Brando was responsible for a lot of good movies and later bad movies and died really, really fat. I just feel I should mention that. It bugs me a little. I mean, in the last few years of his career, he refused to wear pants. We're going to do Brando someday, and I can't wait, because there's so much to unpack with that guy.
Oh, all-time weirdo.
Yeah.
All-time.
Like, somewhere in the 60s, he realized, I'm the biggest star in the world, and I can get away with anything.
Yeah.
So he just kept pushing it. Oh, God.
It's amazing. I can't wait to do that one.
Though. Fantastic. All right, so that's the rewind for you. Now, Midsommar. Or Midsommar, however you want to say it. I'm saying Midsommar because I don't really care.
That's when it came out.
Before we get into the details, is there anything you want to say about this film?
It's the follow-up to Hereditary.
Yeah.
Very, very much, much different than Hereditary.
Oh, yeah.
Let's go ahead and talk about the comparison, get it out of the window. This movie is not as good as Hereditary.
No, not even close.
It doesn't have anywhere near as many roots in horror as Hereditary. In fact, you could say it's not a horror movie. Ari Aster himself calls it a breakup movie that was inspired by a relationship he had. So,
Jesus, that raises a lot of questions.
So does the thing about Hereditary, him having that being based off.
Holy shit.
Yeah, weird life.
Yeah.
But, anyway, I do, off all that, to talk about just this movie and not his first one, I really enjoyed it. There's like a lot of things I took away from it. It was very, very long. It probably could have been, you know, cut. But I hear about a director's cut that's like 3 hours and 45 minutes, and I would love to see
it. Oh, yeah, we're going to mention that. I got that later down the road.
So, I really enjoy it. You know, we'll get into picking nits, and I'll kind of go off of what you say, I think. Whatever you disliked about it, I'll say if I like that or not, and we'll kind of go and figure out what both of us did enjoy or didn't enjoy.
I hope you came prepared, because I've got problems here.
Oh, yeah. I'm ready.
Yeah, and spoiler warning, we're going to dissect the entire movie. So
yeah.
If you haven't seen Midsommar...
That's what we're going to be doing here, especially when it's both of us. That's just going to happen.
If you haven't seen it, shut it off and wait for next week.
Yeah.
So... But come back.
Or listen to the end, because we got some stuff to tell you at the end about what's going on.
So, written and directed by Ari Aster, the brains behind 2018's Hereditary, subject of Filmgazm Episode 18... It has an IMDb score of 7.7, a Rotten Tomatoes score of 82%. I think both of those are high, but we'll just slide right past that. It stars Fighting With My Family star Florence Pugh as Danny Arter, a troubled, grieving student, Jack Rayner as boyfriend Christian Hughes, an anthropology major looking to break free of a dead relationship, Wilhelm Blomgren as Pelle, Christian's Swedish friend who brings his American friends to Hälsingland for the once-in-a-lifetime festival, William Jackson Harper as Josh, the friend looking to write about the Harga for his thesis, and Will Poulter as Mark, the dickhead friend looking to score.
Score in so many ways.
That is his.
He wants to get laid. He wants to get drunk.
That's his one character, like, trait there. He's a dick and he wants to get laid.
And that is the guy, you know, Will Poulter's the guy who's from We Are the Millers. He's the one who gets the tarantula on his pants.
You guys are getting paid?
He was in Detroit, yeah. He plays some odd characters.
Yeah, he was in the running for Pennywise before he went with Bill Skarsgård. But, yeah, he's... I don't know, just... Nobody acts the way you're supposed to act in these situations in this movie. The cast is decent, and they all give great performances, but it really bothered me how oblivious they all are to the very obvious red flags.
Let's start with that, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, well, the way I would defend that, because I actually really like all of the characters, that's like a big part of the young characters, because they're all, you know, in their 20s, just like us, confused, egotistical, very selfish, they all have their own agenda. Not one of them is there for a particularly good or just reason.
Technically, Pele is.
Yes, yeah, oh yeah, I was going to say that. None of the Americans, I guess. Yeah, our main character, yeah, Florence Pugh, I think she's fantastic.
And she does a great job.
I think she has a really good face for horror. I hope she reappears in other horror movies. I think she's great, and she obviously is oblivious, and as the real horror, I think, in this movie is the beginning of the film, when you see what happens.
Yes.
So I guess we can talk about that. But yeah, I really do like the characters, because I think they represent young people really well, and how naive and stupid and, again, egotistical we can be as people.
Yeah, but these aren't supposed to be, like, you know, 19-year-olds. These are doctorate students. Like, these are people who are supposed to have a good head on their shoulders.
The guy who's writing his thesis there, that guy was very focused on that. Really not anything else. Didn't really care. Didn't really seem to bring up any... They're also all on drugs the whole time.
That's true.
Which is huge. That is true. If you've done psychedelics, you know that things become pretty easy to jump into, maybe. You might be a little more willing to, like, to dance, maybe, if you, you know, take some acid or some shrooms, or you might be more compelled to be more active and be more involved in things. And so I think with where they were at, all these kids, they're on God knows what kind of drugs they were giving them, and they were giving them random liquids that who knows what was in it. I think, yeah, it altered their reality, altered their decision-making completely.
Yeah, but there's got to be a point where something is so shocking it breaks through that shit, like watching people willingly kill themselves.
Okay, yeah, then you have Simon, the two British characters, they freak out.
They freak out, and they try to run, and then they just disappear.
Yeah.
And nobody questions that.
Yeah.
Whatever, you know, we'll get to that. So the story begins with Dani losing her entire family to her sister's suicide.
Ugh, man.
Where she duct tapes the doors of her parents' house and kills them both with her. And it is really...
It's brutal.
Oh my God.
The music is shocking, frightening. Yeah. It's a brutal scene. And you're set up thinking, oh my goodness, this is going to be a wild ride.
Yeah.
And you do really think you're in a horror movie at the beginning.
Yeah. And the marketing didn't help.
No, oh no, not at all. No, you can really blame A24 for that. They're in charge of that trailer, and
the trailer was terrifying.
It was.
It's that music.
Mm-hmm. Dun, dun, dun. Yeah, a little ringing and chimes in the background.
Fucking strings. Strings get me. I've talked about that in a couple podcasts. Yeah. Strings get to me when it comes
They're
to
tough,
horror scores.
Yeah.
So Danny's shattered by this. Obviously, she finds comfort in her boyfriend, Christian, who was planning to break off the relationship until this happened, and now he's trapped. And sometime later, Dani finds out that Christian and his friends are planning a trip to Sweden and never told her about it. And in an attempt to make peace, Christian invites Dani on the trip, much to his friend's dismay. They're really pissed. It's a little funny.
It is very funny. Yeah. I think that's another play on, like, man... The way, like, some, like, couples, like, relationships, like, young people communicate,
ugh.
Like, him not telling her about this, going to Sweden, and he acts like it's not a big deal. Like, males think they can get away with this shit and, like, do this to girls, like, manipulate them and make it convenient for them. Like, I don't really want to tell you about this thing that I'm doing.
There's a shit ton of gaslighting in this movie.
Yeah, 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 man. It's like, really frustrating to be like, oh, yeah, that's very real. Like, goes on in a lot of relationships, and I've even been a dickhead before to people I've dated where you're just not keeping them, it's not fair, and you're like not keeping in the loop, and he does this to her continually in the movie.
Yeah.
And it's so frustrating. He sucks. Like,
he's a bad boyfriend and he's a bad friend.
He's terrible.
He ruins his friend's trip too.
Yes, yeah. Yeah, he's a joke. That guy sucks.
He is, yeah.
Decent actor though.
Yeah, way to go. Christian invites Danny on the trip, and she accepts. He didn't think she was going to accept.
It's a little awkward. There's that scene. That's when, what's his name, finds out. Pele finds out that she's going, and he's like, I'm really excited you're going.
And Mark's like, oh, great.
Yeah, it's that's hilarious. The way Will Paul, he's like speechless, and he's like, hey, can I talk to you in the other room?
Not even subtle about it. Just like, oh, go ahead.
Yeah, he's just pissed because he's like, dude, I thought we were going to go here. All of us were going to like turn the other cheek and just all do stupid shit, you know, like as if it's Vegas. Because they think they're going to some like music festival or something in Sweden. And Pele's like, oh, no, no, no. You're all going to die.
He's not very, like, he's not very subtle about it either. He's, like, the way he talks about this is
it would
weird.
Freak me out. Yeah. It'd freak me out. But I really do think, like, their perspective is just so tainted by their agenda. Each of their individual agendas, like, Will Poulter, Mark is like, I'm going to go party, sick, in Sweden? I would love to go to Sweden, personally. Like, that sounds great. Not now, but yeah, there was a time, you know.
I'll go to, like, Stockholm, but I'm not going to the villages.
Yeah, exactly. There you go. Yeah, like, you know, like, if you asked me, like, dude, let's go to Sweden, I'd be like, yeah, man, that sounds great. So I understand his perspective. And then the other guy's like, oh my god, I could write a kick-ass paper doing this, you know. And then, you know, the dominoes are now in effect. It might have been a little cheaper, a little easy, but I think it's all there. Like, the questions are answered for how they're all like, yeah, let's all go here, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know. But, geez. Whew, wish one of them would have thought twice.
Well, when they get to Hälsingland, their Swedish friend Pele, who is from the village, introduces him to his brother Ingemar, who gives them all an extremely psychedelic mushroom.
Ingemar is, like, the guy you want to meet when you, like, go to Europe. You're like, that's the guy you want to run into. Like, that guy's got the drugs.
Within 10 seconds of meeting him, he gets all of them high.
Yeah, that's what we want. That's what we want to do when we go to Sweden, right?
Yeah. It's like, hi, I'm Pele's brother. Do you want mushrooms?
Yeah. Sure. They don't, yeah, they're like, oh, are these safe? Are these, yeah. For a second, Danny does, though. Well, she says she doesn't want to do them.
Yeah, and Christian opts out of it, and they're all like, are you kidding me?
And then Mark is like, dude, we can't all trip on different, you know, timelines. Mm-hmm. We have to start tripping together.
Yeah,
you know?
So, and then Danny gives in, and she hallucinates her dead sister.
Yep.
And
pretty frightening stuff.
Yeah. And things get weird in the village. They go
from
there.
From there on out, at that point, you're like, I don't know what's happening anymore.
No.
Because they're all...
The line is blurred.
They're all off their asses, too. All super high. The way the camera is moving now, you don't quite know where everything is in this village that we're at.
It reminded me of... did you ever watch The Walking Dead?
I watched the first two seasons.
Okay.
And then I gave up.
At the end of season four, the group finds themselves at this refuge called Terminus.
Okay, I remember people talking about that,
And it's the music's so idyllic, and everyone's like, oh, welcome, you found sanctuary. Mm-hmm. And then slowly over the course of the episode, it's revealed that these people are cannibals who've been luring unsuspecting survivors to their group to eat them.
I see. That had to happen at some point in The Walking Dead.
Oh, yeah.
Where someone did that, yeah.
Yeah. And the Americans' arrival into...
What was it called?
Terminus.
Terminus. Welcome.
Yeah, that's exactly how they were. It was like, look no further, this is your sanctuary, and then they were barbecuing people out back.
Yeah.
It was really fucked up. But when the Americans arrived in Hälsingland, I got that same vibe of like,
okay,
this is too happy.
Mm-hmm.
Something's not right here.
For sure. And then, of course, you know from the trailer, like, something bad's gonna happen. Something real bad. Plus, we're in, you know, we're only, I would say, that intro where the stuff happens with her sister... That's, you know, now we're like 15 minutes in, and then they get there, and then, you know, now you're all of a sudden you're 20 minutes in.
Yeah.
And from there on out, yeah, it's just this...
Well, just everybody is so, like, it looks like a Capital One commercial. Like, everybody is just so,
and they're
like,
all dressed in, like, white and flowery
this
things.
This is peace.
It looks very... Yeah, it looks beautiful. It looked amazing on the big screen.
Yeah.
I really think if you wait to see this, like, outside of theaters, you're missing out, because... The coolest part of the movie is how it looks.
I may not have been a big fan of the story, but I think this movie has a serious shot at taking cinematography at the Oscars next year.
Hell yeah.
If they give it a chance.
Ari's got his eye, and I don't know who he has working with him, but did he use the same guy from Hereditary?
Probably.
I think he did, and there's just something going on there that's really special.
Yeah.
They see some cool stuff.
And
when we're getting to the village, the camera's upside down, just
they're
straight upside down.
His angle he took from The Shining.
Yeah, like, super unnerving music. Yeah, and it feels like the same Shining shout-out that we talked about in Hereditary.
Yeah.
So much. Amazing.
Ari is definitely establishing his own visual style, just two films in. And everyone's kind of enjoying this. There's drugs in this weird drink they give him. Everyone's just, you know, skull and having a good time.
People dancing,
And they go to this, like, cliffside gathering where this old person jumps off a cliff and like collapses into bones. And everyone's like, oh, yay. And the Americans are like, what the fuck?
Yeah. Okay. So, yeah, that part's really, really crazy. Yeah. I think this, like, that's a part that could scare the shit out of some people. Me, it was more, like, hard to say captivating because, well, it was, but because the circumstances. This is clearly a tradition of some sort. Yeah. These people are participating in this and watching this happen. An elderly man fall to his death. And then, yeah, like you said, immediately there's two British characters that are there. Simon and I can't really remember the girl's name.
Connie.
Yeah, they're screaming. Like, they're freaked out, and he's saying, what the fuck is going on? The sound kind of goes out where it feels like your ears need to be popped.
Yeah.
And you're just kind of, like, lost in this, you know, static. And they're all just shocked. But my reaction would have been the exact same. I would have been, what the fuck? No, no, no. This, like, that can't.
Yeah.
I do not want to see this. And then you see the hammer, yeah.
Yeah. One of the people who falls off the cliff survives. And then the crowd of villagers...
Because he jumps... Like,
he lands on his legs.
Yeah. It's... it is so intentional.
Yeah. The crowd of villagers...
You're just it is nasty.
They start mimicking his cries of agony.
Yeah.
And then they bash his skull in with a giant mallet one by one, each taking a turn. And of course, this makes things awkward between the Americans and Pele. And they're like, we gotta get the fuck out of here.
What is this? Yeah.
Yeah, Danny's like, I did not sign up for this. But Pele's like, no, we do this once a century.
This is their cycle. Their cycle is over.
Old people die on their own terms.
And you start realizing...
At 72.
Yeah, we start realizing this is like a whole philosophy, the way these people do this thing, and it is 100% a cult. And
yeah.
Now these people are in the thick of it and watching it. And,
yeah. And amazingly, Pele and Ingemar convince these people to stay.
Drugs.
Yeah.
And then, again, at one point Christian says, I'm trying to have an open mind. Are you serious? So, and yeah, that's kind of what the movie's trying to do to you a little bit, is like, is that a good idea to like have like, this is what you do from here to here, it's like more fair, it's like socialism, but to the extreme. Like, oh, and you're like, wait, no. You can't just make people commit suicide when they turn a certain age. Like, that is wild. Yeah. It's a wild way.
But are they making them commit suicide? Because they are walking up there willingly.
Oh, yes, yeah. But it's like a part of their, how
they're
operate.
Grown up to believe in this.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. They're like brainwashed to think that this is a good way to sustain like excellence within our village and keep going strong. Like, ooh, wild.
Yeah.
It's demented, yeah. And the fact that Christian character said that, I was like, of course he would. Yeah. Of course he'd be like, you know what? Like, let's learn. Like, let's see what these people... Let's give them the benefit of the doubt. Like, no.
From the get-go, he is just... He's an awful human being who makes all the wrong decisions.
And what's the other guy's name? The other guy's writing the paper?
Josh.
Josh does the same shit.
Yeah,
he's like, No, this is like... There's different cultures out there. And, you know...
Yeah, and he wants to learn more.
Yeah. Like, I want to keep writing. We need to ask more questions. And he does that shit. And that's what's huge in this movie, is a lot of the plot and what's happening gets explained through just him asking questions about... What is going on here? Or like, why do y'all do this? Why do y'all do that? And Pele answers, and we are the audience, and we're like, oh, wow, they're just telling us kind of how this movie operates. Everything else is just kind of fancy and artsy. So,
yeah,
really, really crazy.
Well, around this time, the two English visitors, Simon and Connie, vanish.
Yeah.
Into thin air under the very thin pretense that they left to catch the train back one at a time.
Yeah. And Connie says, she's like, he wouldn't leave without me, what are you talking about? And she's suspicious, and then, that scene is brutal.
Mm-hmm. Then Christian decides that he's going to copy Josh's thesis idea on the Arga.
Of course!
Because he's just a dick in every possible way.
Yeah. And you know what, I think I'm going to write my paper here. And I love how Josh is just like, looks at him like, are you fucking kidding me, dude? Like, you're really, we're going to both do this now? Oh, man. Oh, I would have been furious if I'm Josh, yeah.
Oh my god, yeah.
So frustrating.
And, of course, Josh is pissed, causes a rift between them, and Josh tries to get a jump start on his thesis, and he goes to ask for info on the ancient runes that house the cult's ritualistic practices.
Boy.
And they're based
on... I don't want to go in there.
No, it's like their church with their weird Bible. And their book, or like their tome, is based on paintings by an oracle... who is a deformed cult member born out of intentional incest.
That's also explained in the movie.
Yeah.
Like, he point blank asked that,
yeah.
And he tells him, oh yeah, It's incest.
Yeah.
We want that here. That's something we encourage.
What the fuck? Yeah. Oh, my God.
People.
And soon after that, Mark, the dickhead friend, accidentally pisses on an ancestral tree and burial ground, and shit gets pretty tense.
Yeah.
Yeah. He gets called out pretty fast, and this one guy's like, "How dare you?" And Mark's like, "Whoa, I shed a piss."
Yeah, it's just a tree, man. Like, it's not a big deal.
And he's lured away from the others by an attractive female cult member, because these people know exactly what he's after. And later that night, Josh sneaks back into the temple to photograph the sacred text after he was explicitly told not to do that, and is distracted by an aggressively moaning man wearing Mark's face.
Oh.
Josh is then bashed over the head and dragged from the temple. Idiot that I am, once I saw the vaguely Mark-looking assailant, my first thought went to zombie.
Just, oh, shit, here we go.
Yeah, I was like, oh, shit, what? They did something to Mark, but no, that makes...
Oh, man.
Yep, wearing his face makes much more sense.
He's like Dwight Schrute, the...
Yeah, that's what I thought, yeah. I was like, oh, shit.
Oh, man.
I felt so like an good. Idiot once I realized that. Oh, yeah, it's not a zombie. That was I was Mark's. Like, they never explained that, but then I'm like, oh, yeah, they didn't have to, because it didn't happen. That one was my bad. The next day, Danny is coerced into taking more hallucinogens... Yep. And joins a dancing competition wherein the last one standing wins it all. And Danny wins and is crowned the May Queen. During this, Christian is also drugged and cheats on Danny in a sex ritual where he impregnates cult member Maya while the other females watch and mimic her pleasure in a very weirdly disturbing scene.
Yeah, yeah.
And
kind of funny.
Yeah, weirdly funny.
Because you're like watching Christian's facial expressions. He's like, huh? And then the old lady starts pushing on his ass from behind.
They're helping him.
Really weird. Really weird scene. Yeah.
And scenes like this really hammer home the idea that this cult is one soul. They are one people. And they share each other's happiness, their misery, their agony, their pleasure.
Yes.
All of it.
Yes.
And that's a very weird way to... I don't know. It's just... it's I've never seen anything like that before.
Yeah. Such an odd way to operate. Huh?
Extremely, yeah.
Oh, man.
And Danny discovers Christian's infidelity and flies into a panic attack.
And that scene is like, whew.
Yeah.
Oh, boy. The image of her when when she's freaking out and she's running and you don't quite know where and everything is, like where she is in the village. It's we didn't really bring up that it's fucking daylight like the whole time.
Yeah, the sun
and
never
it's almost
sets
annoying
here.
Because you're like getting tired and, with them and you're like, oh my God, this movie, like, can we... figure anything out? Or are these people just going to keep being dumb? They just keep being dumb. And it's just like this cycle, and you can't, it won't stop. And it's
the mentality of like the teenagers in a Friday the 13th movie, but in an art film. It's very.
With
weird
so many
combat.
Drugs involved. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And Danny's screams of agony are very similar to the screams that she had when she found her family dead.
Yes. And then, of course, there's people gathered around her. Where, like, it's by where she sleeps at this place.
And they're screaming with her.
All the same. Very unsettling to hear that.
And Christian discovers Josh's partially buried severed leg and finds Simon, the English boy, flayed ritualistically to resemble an eagle. And then he is paralyzed by one of the elders who, like, blows some kind of dust in his face. The cult explains that this festival culminates in a series of sacrifices. 9, to be exact. The first 4 were outsiders, Josh, Mark, Simon, and Connie. The next 4 are cult members, the 2 dead elders from earlier, Ingemar and an unnamed villager. As May Queen, Danny has the right and honor to choose the final victim. Not a good time to be her adulterous boyfriend.
Yeah, no.
Enraged and heartbroken, she chooses Christian, who is then sewn up into the corpse of a disemboweled bear, for some reason, and placed in a temple alongside the bodies of the other sacrifices. The temple is then set ablaze, and Christian burns alive as Danny watches in horror, which slowly turns to psychotic joy. She is now one of them.
Yes, the May Queen.
She ain't going back. She's got nothing left.
Well, no, there's no one to go back with, either.
Yeah.
And your family's gone, too, so, yeah. She became a part of this cult, throughout the movie.
And that's it. That's the story of Midsommar.
Yeah.
Take all that, stretch it into 2.5 hours, and you've got Midsommar. It's an interesting enough story. It is a breakup film that's marketed as a horror film.
Yes.
And that's really one of the issues I have. This was not marketed correctly.
I understand that. It is frustrating. It sucks that you didn't like it either. Like,
yeah,
I do. I like movies that are like intentionally artsy, and
I don't very much.
Yeah, like, yeah, like, you know, yeah. We've talked about our differences, and sometimes you much prefer a plot based something that has a strong story and strong characters, and I can go for. Sometimes, like, I mean, my favorite movie is Magnolia, so it's just a lot of like editing and these wide shots and unnecessarily long like pauses, and I like that stuff because it's just different and kind of offbeat. And Midsommar is way different than anything I've ever seen. I think there, well, you know, I think there's similarities to Wicker Man in the 70s, as far as plot points and things that happen with the female that he impregnates. There's some similarities there, but I think as visually and as just a movie from this decade, it's like, wow, this is fresh as it gets.
It can't be fresh and built off The Wicker Man for me. Like, that was a much more solid film about cults. The ending is almost exactly the same, and I feel like The Wicker Man was tighter. It was creepier, because with that movie, you genuinely do not know what's going on until the last 5 minutes. But this film, you are laid out everything almost from the get-go.
Yeah. I don't have like any questions about her Midsommar at all.
Yeah.
Of like plot points that didn't get answered or questions that went unanswered. I don't have any. I don't. And that's like, that was big for me. This is crazy. It's really cool. We've never disagreed on.
I know, this is interesting.
But it's also, I also understand, because the flaws that you're pointing out are kind of some things that I like. Like, that's really hard to justify or to explain, but I just like things that are, that I haven't seen, that I haven't, and if that's intentional or maybe on purpose or a little too on the nose, I'm okay with that. Like, it, and I love him so much, Ari Aster. I might be biased. I might just be such a huge Hereditary fan that I believe in him as like a filmmaker, and I've listened to podcasts with him on them. So I might be biased. I'll be open to that. But it is fascinating how much more I liked it than you. But at the same time, I don't have like ammo to go at you like, well, you should like it because of this, because I totally understand your take on it. I totally get it, because those things are true. It is, the characters are dumb. They're dumb throughout the whole thing, and their decisions are stupid. And say no to drugs, kids. You know, that's.
And I get your take on the movie too, because it is a beautifully filmed movie.
It looks like we didn't talk about how there's objects just have a pulse. Everything has a pulse. Yeah. And it's like, whoa, it's mesmerizing at times.
This,
like,
movie is filled with life.
Yes, and she, like, she, when she has the, like, May Queen thing on and it's all floating around and moving, I was like, this is breathtaking stuff. Like, and she's beautiful. Florence Pugh is beautiful, and it just looked really cool in the broad daylight with everything's white, and
yeah,
it felt like, you know, like those like infomercials for weird places, you know, come join us. Like you said, the thing from Walking Dead.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, yeah, so I guess we really need to figure out what, because like you're saying, it does feel like those 70s like cult movies, pagan cult movies, and The Wicker Man especially, but it also is fresh, so.
I was just hoping it was going to do something new with that formula.
Yeah.
But it's the same,
that's,
you know,
fair.
Americans go there, Americans are sacrificed.
I guess we don't see a lot of, like, the pagan cult thing, like, kind of had its time during the 70s, and that generally have a whole lot more life since, you know. So I think it's cool, maybe, I don't know, I've heard him talk a little bit about that. I think he's not getting questioned enough about that he, not stole from movies, but, you know, I mean, come on, you know.
Yeah, the homages are a little
on
the nose sometimes.
Whereas the Hereditary is, it's more of like, here's a camera angle, not a plot point that was like, he took stuff like that was cinematography-wise or tone or visually, but not for your actual story and characters and development. So it's very hard to, like, decipher, I guess, and to determine like what is right and what's wrong. But I don't know, I end up giving this movie, for me, I end up giving an 8.
Really?
Yeah, that's my score of it.
Wow. Like
8 out of 10.
Alright. Well, I disagree.
Did you give it, what did you give it?
I gave it a 5.
5, yeah.
Out of sheer frustration, lack of any real scares that were promised by the trailers, thought the marketing was all wrong, and I just think it doesn't need to be 2.5 hours, and it doesn't do anything new for me. And I was disappointed.
That's fair.
I think I expected too much after Hereditary was so good.
Yeah. It was. That's such a hard one to follow up.
It really.
And you know, we did this with back in whatever February or March when Us came out.
Yeah. Talk about a double whammy for me, man.
Yeah, you know, Jordan Peele, here comes his second movie, and just doesn't have as much girth or as much you know, meat to it as the first one did. So I don't know.
Well,
it's tough, but would you recommend people to see it or no? Like, if someone who's just like, I like going to see movies, would you be like, go see Midsommar?
Casually, no.
No. Yeah.
But a hardcore film buff, yes.
Yeah.
And a horror buff, yes. I think, you know, we can only say so much. I think you need to see this film to judge it for yourself.
It's for sure. For sure. And I think a big part of it being made was because of the momentum Hereditary got, you know, with A24. And it made like $80 million. Midsommar has now made like 25. I really don't think it would have made any money if it wasn't for...
This thing would have been dumped on Netflix.
What happened a year ago? So he kind of was able to do this. And I know he had been working on it for like 4 years. This story and this whole thing. So it's like something.
I get the feeling that he is a director who doesn't want to make horror films, but he used that as a way to break in. That's the vibe I'm getting, because whenever he talks about his movies, he doesn't label them as horror films.
He doesn't label them as anything.
Hereditary, he said, was a family drama. Midsommar, he does say
that he's like, there's clearly, he's like, Hereditary is clearly like, I want it to be like what it turned out to be, this like big like summer horror thing that was really scary.
Yeah,
he's like, people love it, and he's like, that's what I wanted. And he's like, with this, I wanted to do something that was just gonna shock people and make people think and have questions. So
see, I don't think he did that.
I don't think he did either, but I liked what he did. I really don't know what his intentions were with this movie, but I liked it for what the characters, how I like that there's representation for how dumb 20-something-year-olds can be, because I deal with them. I am one of them, and I have been very stupid at times, and that's how we actually are. And so there's also times in horror movies where you see like, well, how the fuck are they like in like Don't Breathe, I'm like, they'd all die. Like, they can't, you know, if I was in that situation, I'd be so freaked out, I'd just like give up. Like, my mentally, but for whatever reason, people in movies have like that adrenaline, like extra, I'm gonna, you know, do things that I'm not capable of, you know, because it's a movie. And this was the opposite way of, we are so dumb, and we're like letting them do exactly what they want, and we're all gonna end up being sacrifices. Nice. Like, good job, guys. Good trip to Sweden.
Man. 3 out of 5 stars. Would not recommend a trip to Sweden.
No, yeah, no.
So here's some Filmgazm facts. I didn't have a lot. The trivia in this movie is very limited.
Yeah, well, it did just come out too. You know, we just saw this a couple weeks ago. So,
number one, the film was originally given an NC-17. According to Ari Aster, around 30 minutes was cut from the final film, mainly due to content, and a director's cut is planned for home release. Unbelievably, he wanted this film to be longer.
Yeah. Oh, I can't wait to watch that.
Christ. What more could he put in there?
Another hour and 15 is apparently what's coming.
What? I thought the thing needed to be trimmed down even further, and he's putting more in there. God damn it.
I'm in.
Number two, according to Ari Aster, this was meant to be his first horror movie, since Hereditary was intended to just be a family drama. Jesus.
Such a strange... He's a strange guy, man.
Yeah.
But I'm all in. Keep making movies, man. Especially with A24, I'm in. I'm with it.
He's got to earn back some points with me.
So does Jordan Peele, man.
Yeah. Number three, the fate of Simon in the film is based on the Vikings' supposed use of a torture called Blood Eagle, in which victims were placed in a prone position, their ribs severed from the spine with a sharp tool, and their lungs pulled through the opening to create a pair of wings.
Oh, man.
It's a brutal torture.
And I that's the scene when Christian's like naked and running around.
Yeah.
And he stumbles into that. And, mm-hmm. Oh, boy.
Yeah.
Nice.
And that's all we got really for Filmgazm facts.
Simon. There you go, Simon.
Final thoughts?
Final thoughts? I just want people to see it, to check it out. Because I don't know. I think it's...
Yeah.
We got stuff to offer.
I would say the same thing. You know... Art is subjective, above all else.
Exactly. Sometimes you can't explain, like, I just like that painting.
Yeah.
I don't know. The colors are cool.
Not everything's going to do it for everybody, and that film could be somebody else's favorite movie. It's entirely subjective.
Oh, there's people I know that, I've seen, you know, like, adore this film and think it's this masterpiece, and I would never go there, but...
And regardless of my personal tastes, the film was widely praised by critics and audiences alike. So, you know, do it for yourself.
Yeah, go check it out.
Yeah. What do you got to lose besides 2.5 hours?
And just some of your mental sanity. It's a weird one.
Yeah.
I think we didn't sell that enough, how weird.
It's weird.
How just odd some of the imagery is, and like, have I ever seen that? No, I don't think so. Or just like, do we really just watch two old-ass people just commit suicide? I don't know.
Really.
Fucking strange.
So let's get into what happened this week in film. It was another big week, especially with Comic-Con.
Oh, yeah.
And,
huge stuff.
We're going to lead up to that. We're going to talk all about what Marvel announced this week.
The machine does not stop.
No, it does not. It's only picking up traction here. So first up, Javier Bardem is in talks to play King Triton in Disney's upcoming live-action Little Mermaid remake.
Oh, yeah.
Currently in pre-production. Love Javier. Would totally buy him as King Triton.
That's becoming a more and more interesting movie for me to go see in theaters. Because the people who are signed on to do that. I think I'm like more excited for that than I am Lion King.
Alright.
That might be a little weird, because I wasn't even that into Little Mermaid as a kid. But
you remember you telling me you weren't really into Lion King either.
No, Disney movies are hard. Yeah. We'll have to do a whole podcast on Disney.
That's on the docket.
Because the ones I like a lot are just like the Goofy movie.
I love a Goofy movie.
Yeah, like, to me, that is just so damn original. And it's, like, their characters. Like, you know, it's Goofy and Max, you know, and that's, like, really genius to me. Whereas, you know, most of their other movies, Lion King and this and that, just kind of take from other stories or, I don't know. It's just not as original as I'd like it to be, so.
Fair enough.
But, you know, that's for another, we'll eventually do a big Disney.
Yeah, I was actually planning when Disney Plus gets released.
That'd be
when
fun,
we're
going to
be doing the Disney podcast.
Disney podcast. We might have to stretch that over a couple just because there's so much to talk about with them.
Yeah.
They're like the Hitler of the film industry. They just take everything.
Shit. Wow, okay.
You've never heard that?
I have not, but if we get shut down next week, you'll know why.
We can cut that one out, yeah.
Goddamn. Producer Barbara DeFina is working with musician Tommy James to do a film adaptation of James' autobiography, Me, the Mob, and Music. It'll be a biopic of the 60s rock group Tommy James and the Shondells, who are behind such hits as Crimson and Clover and Crystal Blue Persuasion.
Sweet.
I like Tommy James and the Shondells, and of course they were involved with the mob every 60s.
Yeah.
So I'm in.
That sounds cool.
This one pissed me off. Criminal charges against Kevin Spacey have been dropped after his accuser opted to plead the fifth on the witness stand. In this case, Spacey had been accused of groping a young man in a Nantucket bar in 2016, and he pled not guilty. The prosecution had lost their key evidence, and the witness was uncooperative, so the case was thrown out. Now, this was decisive. He was facing 5 years in prison for assault. But now he's getting away scot-free. And this is not the only incident. He's up for a lot of different accusations here.
Oh, man.
And he beat this one. So, we'll see what happens in the future, but I would bet money that he's going to get away with all this shit.
Probably. Sad to say.
Just how it goes. Mm-hmm. He's rich, he's famous, and...
That helps in our society.
He's got cachet to throw around. It's a shame. Next up, actor David Hedison died at age 92. He was best known for his role of James Bond's CIA friend and ally, Felix Leiter, in 1973's Live and Let Die, and 1989's License to Kill. He's one of the few actors to play Felix Leiter more than once.
Ah.
And we are going to do a Bond franchise episode down the road.
Of course.
Probably next year when the 25th comes out.
Hell yeah.
Yeah. Damn. Next year. We're in this for the long haul. this one was cool. Edward Furlong is returning to the role of John Connor in the upcoming Terminator Dark Fate. Furlong previously played John Connor in 1991's Terminator 2 Judgment Day. And he's been in and out of rehab since then, so I think it's weird that they're bringing him back.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, I get the, you know, fan appeal, but wouldn't they rather go with a safer, like, big-name actor?
Yeah, yeah, someone who's going to sell tickets.
Like, in the past, you know, Christian Bale, Jason Clarke, Edward Furlong again.
Yeah, oh.
But I guess they don't really need, I mean, you know, they have Linda Hamilton and Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Yeah,
they don't need anybody
else. That's true.
But I'm excited. I love the Terminator franchise.
It's going to be fun. Yeah. Oh, damn right, yeah.
Now for trailers. There were a lot of trailers. First up, Top Gun Maverick. and I don't really give a shit.
Neither do I.
I don't like Top Gun.
Not a fan.
I don't think there needs to be a sequel. My grandma, who was in the military, pointed out that his conduct would get his ass thrown out of the military, and that really upset her.
Yeah, it's completely unrealistic the way they act, yeah.
Ugh. I don't get it. It's Tom Cruise's ego trip. He needs to be the hero. He needs to be the young guy on the motorcycle in the jet plane. He can't move on.
Oh, man.
And he's basically worshipped as a god in his own cult, so he doesn't need to move on.
Oh, Tommy.
Yeah.
Tommy. Fascinating guy.
Oh, my God. The trailer for Cats was released, and it looks like bizarre nightmare fuel. Anthropomorphic cats with human faces walking and dancing around. Who the fuck thought that was a good idea?
I'm good. I didn't even watch the trailer.
I watched it a couple times, and it's weird.
Because it looks so strange.
Yeah, it's like a nightmare. It doesn't make any sense. Why would anybody... Scary. Who is this for? It's like they made a movie for the furry community. It makes no sense.
God.
And they got big names. They got Ian McKellen, Judi Dench, Idris Elba. Like, really good names to do this shit.
There must be something that we don't know.
They're going to be cats. What the fuck, man?
Ugh.
Yeah.
Oh, boy.
The trailer for Jay and Silent Bob reboot was released, starring Jason Mewes and Kevin Smith as Jay and Silent Bob. And Supergirl's Melissa Benoist as the rebooted version of Chronic, who, along with Bluntman, were the superheroes based on Jay and Silent Bob in Kevin Smith's View Askewniverse. And this is his first revisit to that universe in a long time. I think his last one was Clerks 2.
Mm-hmm.
And it looks really dumb, but I'm going to see it.
That's exactly what I was going to say.
Yeah.
Of course, yeah. They have part of my soul. I love those guys.
Who doesn't love Kevin Smith? And I want to see Melissa Benoist swear. That's a big part of it.
Hell yeah. Hell yeah. So you know what's coming. Something rowdy is going to happen.
Oh, my God. Yeah. I mean, in the first Jay and Silent Bob, they had Mark Hamill say one of my favorite lines, "Don't fuck with a Jedi Master, son." God damn, man.
So cool that happened in pop culture.
It's the weirdest, man. Oh. Next up, and this looks really nice, the trailer for A Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood was released, starring Tom Hanks as Fred Rogers.
Oh, yeah.
It covers Mr. Rogers' friendship with a jaded journalist who interviewed him for a magazine. And could you get a more perfect union of actor and subject? I mean,
of two humans, yeah.
The nicest man in Hollywood playing the nicest man who ever lived. It's going to be great.
It really is.
It's going to be such a sweet film.
Mm-hmm.
And we need something like that. We need a heartwarming
this
film.
Year has been not very good.
No.
So, yeah, we need that big one that's going to make us all cry.
Yes, we do. This one, I'm so happy to hear about this. David Gordon Green and Jamie Lee Curtis are attached to two more Halloween films, 2020's Halloween Kills and 2021's Halloween Ends.
I can't believe this. That's real.
Couldn't be more excited.
I'm so fucking hyped.
Yeah.
You know what's really cool is that there's going to be a new... A, like, clean, new Halloween trilogy.
Yes!
We just had our one.
Yes!
We finally get our rounded, clean trilogy of good Halloween movies.
Oh, man.
So happy. That now I can just be like, the first one's really good, and then the trilogy's really good, and then move on, you know?
I'm so happy. This is, ugh.
Yeah.
Halloween 2018 was one of my favorite films
Brianna and I, my girlfriend and I, we're so excited. This is
fantastic.
Huge, great news for us. Yeah.
And now for the really good stuff. Marvel had their big day and announced their Phase 4 lineup. Prior to that announcement, Avengers Endgame finally overtook Avatar and became the highest grossing movie of all time.
Thank God, because I couldn't stand seeing fucking Avatar up there anymore.
$2.781 billion worldwide. It won the war. And on Marvel's big day. What are the fucking odds? It was probably manufactured.
Yeah. Oh, wait, they control a lot. Shit.
Disney, who owns Marvel and Avatar, probably, fudged the numbers a little bit. But who cares? It was still exciting news. We're at the bottom of the pecking order here. We're allowed to enjoy the manufactured
the
good
drama,
news sometimes.
Yeah, drama of the industry. Yeah.
Here's the Phase 4 lineup. Holy shit. Phase 4 will kick off with Black Widow in May 2020, which will feature Scarlett Johansson returning to the role.
Finally.
Yeah.
How long did that have to take for them to realize?
10 years.
Hey, Scarlett Johansson's pretty damn good at this. We should let her...
It's going to be a prequel. It's going to cover the much-talked-about Budapest mission. So, we'll get to see how that went down. And then in fall 2020, we're going to get the first of many Disney Plus series, The Falcon and the Winter Soldier. which will have a 6-episode full drop and will kind of bridge the gap. And these are going to be full Marvel production quality shows.
Wow.
Like, it's going to star Sebastian Stan and Anthony Mackie and Daniel Brühl as Helmut Zemo.
Wow.
So, and who knows who else could pop in. It's going to be fantastic. November 2020, we'll see the release of Eternals, another cosmic-based Marvel adventure starring Angelina Jolie and Richard Madden, among others.
Jeez.
That one's kind of the only oddball here. I'm excited. I mean, I didn't know who the hell the Guardians of the Galaxy were until 2014.
Yeah.
And that's one of the best movies. So I have faith.
Whose is that? Who's directing that? Or
Eternals. Oh, it was a...
Did it say?
It did.
Here, I can look it up while you keep going with the... Yeah.
It was a good name, too. It had a really...
That's important, I think, for...
This section of... this phase is very diverse in regards to actor and filmmaker.
Well, yeah, I mean, they have... Why not? After Thor Ragnarok came out, and they're like, oh, if we just get guys who are, like, creative and can, like, do comedy, do something serious, do this, do that, and just let them have these all-time huge characters that we all love?
Yeah.
It's going to be a good movie if you do that.
Absolutely.
Chloe Zhao?
Chloe Zhao.
Yeah, Chloe Zhao. Okay. Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Right on. Wow.
I know.
That's really cool.
Well, I found out the guy who... there was a guy who was running...
Kumail is in it.
Yeah, Kumail Nanjiani's in it.
Oh, Brian Terry Henry. Salma Hayek. Oh, yeah. That's
loaded cast. Great. It's going to be fantastic.
See, I like that. If it's something new, like you said, with the Guardians, that was such a great little surprise.
Well, there was a guy. His name was, I think, Ike Barinholtz or something like that. He ran half of Marvel. And he was the guy who kept shutting down female directors and female-led superhero movies.
His name?
Ike something. And he was...
Shit, that's the guy I need to be mad at. Yeah.
Well, he's the guy who said female superhero movies won't sell toys. And Kevin
Just
Feige,
female? Or was he talking about, like, anything outside of their own, you know, like, what we know, you know, Iron Man?
No, he straight up said female.
Just female.
Will not
sell
toys.
Okay. Yeah, that's ridiculous.
So Kevin Feige went to Disney execs, and they fired his ass immediately.
Oh,
and
God,
Kevin
dude.
Feige was given full control
over
Marvel. And now that guy's out, so now Kevin Feige is being all diverse, and he's giving everybody a chance to shine.
Letting people do stuff.
And I love that.
Yeah.
And after the Eternals, we get into 2021, which will kick off with Shang-Chi and the Legend of the Ten Rings, Marvel's first Asian major player. And it will co-star Tony Leung as the true Mandarin. And Tony Leung is a John Woo guy, old school Chinese actor. Very excited. Very
fantastic.
Good choice for the Mandarin. And I really hope they just blow Ben Kingsley's brains out in the first 5 minutes of that movie. And I bet they will.
Hell yeah.
Yeah. That movie's going to make Iron Man 3 better just in retrospect.
Okay. Cool. I'm sure that's part of their agenda now is to make other things more effective because of more story.
Yeah. And I know nothing about Shang-Chi. I've never heard of that one, so I've done some research, and it sounds really cool. It's like Marvel's kick-ass kung fu master guy. It's going to be cool.
Sweet.
Then in spring 2021, we get WandaVision, which has a dumb title, admittedly, but it's another Disney Plus series featuring Elizabeth Olsen's Scarlet Witch and Paul Bettany's Vision. I've heard that'll have some pretty cool impact on the MCU as a whole.
For sure.
And in May 2021, we will get Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness. Very excited. And that'll feature Elizabeth Olsen's Scarlet Witch, and the main villain will be the interdimensional fear demon Nightmare, who last I heard was being Matt Smith of Doctor Who was being courted to play him, which would be great.
Yeah, that's a good call.
Then in spring 2021, we'll get another Disney Plus series, Loki, starring Tom Hiddleston as the Loki that escaped with the Tesseract in Avengers Endgame. Where did he go? We will find out. God, this is such... we're getting so much content. I'm so excited
about
this.
It's ridiculous. Disney Plus is going to change everything.
And just what is going to be available on that thing? Like all the Marvel movies, Disney movies, Star Wars movies, Pixar movies, all the Fox movies.
They own everything.
Miramax. Like everything is going to be on that thing.
It's all theirs.
I'm so excited. Summer 2021, we'll see an animated series called What If that will explore alternate timelines and feature a heavy-hitting voice cast of almost everybody who's been in a Marvel movie. And the first episode will be What If Peggy Carter Became Captain America instead of Steve Rogers.
Oh, man.
So, boom. It's going to be really cool. Then in fall 2021, we're going to get a Hawkeye series starring Jeremy Renner. And then in November 2021, we will get Thor Love and Thunder, which will see the return of Natalie Portman as Jane Foster, who will become the Lady Thor. which was a arc they did in the comics in the past 2 or 3 years, which is weird because I thought Natalie Portman was done with this big time.
Me too.
But I guess she just wanted a meatier role, and so they're like, all right, you want to be Thor? She's like, yes.
Of course. I need some money. Yeah.
But the coolest news, though, was the casting of Mahershala Ali as Blade.
I was about to say, that was like the only one I knew about.
In an upcoming feature that will be the start of Phase 5.
Oh, boy.
Blade! I thought they were going to either like do that as a very low-key series or not do it at all, but that's going to be like a mainstay of their film. Oh, my God.
Instead, it's going to be like just as cool as Wesley Snipes.
And I really hope that they keep it rated R. I've heard that they're going to keep Deadpool R.
I think they will.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because Blade is an R-rated character.
When I got texted about that, like multiple, I got multiple texts from people like, holy fuck, Ali as Blade? Like,
yeah.
That is perfect. And I was like, oh, that's sick. You know, that was the first thing I heard.
Well, my favorite part about that news is he came to them.
Oh, so cool.
He was like, I want to play Blade.
I really think that he's, Ali, you know, he's an actor's actor, and I think older people, adults, like him a lot. Not as much kids. Kids don't really, how they really know who he is, you know? The stuff he's been in is, like, award movies, and True Detective, you know? Like, kids aren't watching that stuff. So, I think what I'm trying to say in a roundabout way is they gotta make it R, because it's Mahershala Ali, which adults love. That's, like, our guys. Like, we go to the movies to watch guys like him.
And Blade is a straight-up horror movie with vampires.
Like, yeah, and if you're gonna, like... His style is just as cool as Wesley Snipes. You're like, let's just bring it back. Yeah, I don't know.
Well, I think the fact that he went to them proves that he is going to care about this. He doesn't need to do this. He wants to do this.
Dude, this is going to be perfect.
Yeah,
I've never been more excited for a Marvel movie, a superhero movie. Yeah,
Blade. I'm so excited.
Yeah, it's going to be sick.
And then Kevin Feige teased the Fantastic Four.
Okay,
and the X-Men will be coming soon. In probably Phase 5, the mutants will return, is what he said.
Okay.
And
Phase 5.
This is just Phase 1 of Phase 4 that he mentioned. We still got to talk about Black Panther 2, Guardians of the Galaxy 3.
Yeah.
All of those are coming in future announcements. But, God, DC Comics have got to be just, like, in the bathtub with razor blades to the wrist right now. Because the war is over.
Oh, God. Like, yeah.
Yeah. They are hopping off a cliff in a Swedish village.
It's not even them. It's like Disney, Marvel. We own all of you. Like, all of you are ours.
I'm waiting for Disney to buy Warner Brothers so we can get Batman on the Avengers.
Oh, jeez.
They would do that shit.
That's the thing is it's... anything can change. And like anything because of the amount of money and like what they can just suck up. It's scary.
I'm surprised Sony's
Star
even,
Wars! Like, yeah. I still sometimes have to like process that in my brain. That... Disney, who I grew up thinking, yes, the Goofy movie, and Lion King, and Aladdin, and no, they own Star Wars, and these movies we're talking about, and it's insane. It really is. If you really think about it, you're like, oh my God.
Yeah. I'm surprised Sony's even willing to, like, you know, test Disney.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
Disney bought Fox just to make a point. Does Sony think they even have, like, what, they have Venom 2, and a Morbius movie with Jared Leto that nobody gives a shit about? And they're trying to withhold Spider-Man? Dude, Disney's going to fuck them up.
Yeah.
Like, they're going to buy that whole studio just to get Spider-Man, like, you know, full custody.
Disney is Thanos in Infinity War. Yeah. Like, 100%.
He's got they got five stones.
Oh, yeah. All five stones in full effect.
They need one left, and they are going to rip it from Sony's cold, dead head. And honestly, I want them to.
Yeah, I want Thanos to win. I kind of want Thanos to win.
I'm tired of Sony fucking around. They have fucked up every major franchise they've ever had.
Yeah,
Ghostbusters fucked it up. Amazing Spider-Man fucked it up. Venom, they got lucky.
Venom, and we're like in the minority here. Yeah. We actually are some of the people who do like Venom.
Yeah. But I'm worried that because they got lucky, they're going to micromanage the fuck out of Venom 2, and it's going to be a disaster.
Probably.
So,
probably.
Yeah.
And then it's going to make Venom seem dumb, because then it's like, oh, well, what's the point of having an origin movie that has a follow-up that sucks? You know?
Yeah.
Then it affects that, and yeah. You have to take care of your shit. Marvel does.
Yeah.
They take care of their shit.
The whole reason Sony...
They make...
Like,
yeah, they... Yeah.
The whole reason Sony agreed with this joint custody deal with Spider-Man in the first place was because The Amazing Spider-Man 2 was such a failure. They had no choice.
It's a joke.
But now they're starting to get a big head on their shoulders because Homecoming and Far From Home were big hits.
Mm-hmm.
And they're thinking it's their Like, they're responsible for that success? Fuck you, Sony.
Ridiculous.
Ugh, I guess it's my turn for the rant this time.
Yeah. I like to take turns, so.
Fuck. Yeah, Sony just,
Suck a dick, Sony.
Grinds my gears. Well, thank you for being part of our tiny cult here on Filmgazm. If you enjoyed this episode, feel free to subscribe to the podcast, iTunes, YouTube, Podbean. Check out our social media, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. Leave us a suggestion, filmgasm@gmail.com. We welcome all feedback. If there's anything you want us to talk about, we'd love to. And I hope you can join us next week, where I'm going to go back to Stephen King with a hint of George Romero for the 1982 cult horror anthology classic Creepshow.
Oh, yeah.
Which features five separate horror shorts and an all-star cast of 80s actors. It's one of my favorites. I can't wait to discuss it. And in the meantime, stay away from remote Swedish villages. I mean, just, you know, that's good advice. And we'll see you next Wednesday.